Okay, it's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. We're back at VK with Alex Oana. How are you?
Hi, Warren. It's great to see you. Thanks for coming back.
Thank you. Yeah. Now, I don't know much about anything, really.
Come on, admit it.
Well, no, one of the things I don't know anything about, this is crazy, I've never actually used barefoots.
Oh, they're really good.
Okay, so...
Better than good.
Okay, good. So, I wanted to kind of get... This is going to be interesting because what we're going to do is we're in an environment where... It's just going to be you and I listening to speakers and talking about them.
Like the many demos I do, it's just like this.
Yeah, exactly.
You brought some music?
I brought some music. What I thought about was this band I worked with a few years ago, about 7 years ago, called Vedera. And the reason why I like this album is because, you know, I recorded the album, but we had three different mixes on it. And those mixes happened to be Mark Ender, Spike Stent, and Serban Gurnier.
My favorites.
Yeah, so three great pop, rock, you know, mixes.
Right.
So we know they're going to sound great. Mm-hmm. They do sound great.
We know the content's good. Now we're going to see how it translates.
So, and I know it really well. So unfortunately, you guys are going to have to trust my rambling opinions. But we're going to do the same thing we did with the microphones. Mm-hmm. And you're going to give us an idea of who is buying this, what kind of applications. Because that's the number one thing that I get asked is like, what should I buy? And I always respond with, well, you know, tell me more. Tell me your budget. We talked about it before. Mm-hmm. Budget. What's your budget, first of all? And then secondly, what's your environment? What kind of music do you make? You know, lots of stuff that really is very dependent, that really really points us towards specific speakers. And so I'm looking here quite mystified because I've never used the barefoots. I've never used these focals. There's a lot of stuff. So I'm going to be at your mercy here. With a lot of questions.
It can be slightly overwhelming, but that's the whole point of the showroom, is to come in and find a pair of monitors that works for your ears. You know, why isn't there a perfect set of monitors?
Sure.
Because we all hear differently. Rooms are different sizes. We need a different level. We need a different amount of sub.
Sure.
So that's why you're doing the perfect thing. If you were here for the first time doing a demo, I'd say you're doing the perfect thing. You brought material you know. And you're just going to open your ears and see what these monitors sound like.
So unfortunately, you're only going to be hearing through these little tiny lapel mics.
But if we stand just the right distance apart,
in stereo. Okay, well, let's get started.
Let's.
I don't mind. Where do you want to start? You tell me.
Okay, you mentioned barefoots. You haven't really experienced them before. On this side, we have five sets of mid to high-end monitors. Two pairs of barefoots, two different price ranges. PMCs, Focals, and ATCs. These are all great near fields, but that are also full range. So let's start with a pair of barefoot MM35 Gen 2s.
Which ones are those?
That's these right here. And just to give you guys a reference point, one of the most popular near field speakers or mid near field speakers is the barefoot MM27. And they really... they really have become a new studio standard. You know, you used to always see the white cone Yamaha NS10s, and still sometimes you do. It's interesting that a $10,000 speaker, essentially, the barefoot MM27s, have replaced that as the ubiquitous studio speaker, ubiquitous near field monitor. So this is the baby version, the MM35. Voiced, if I use the word voiced, let me just explain what that means. So how can you have different speakers, different size drivers sound similar, sound like they belong to a family? Like like Focals, their speakers tend to be voiced the same. Adam speakers, ATC speakers, they tend to be voiced the same. Same with the barefoot MM35s, voiced to sound just like their big brother, the MM27s.
Sure.
Part of that's done through DSP. Part of that's done through, it's done through the magic of the speaker designer's whims. So
what are we talking about? You're saying it's the cheaper version. What? How much is cheaper?
It's the more affordable version.
More affordable.
Yeah.
There you go. More affordable.
Yeah. And so these speakers are in the $7,000 to $10,000 range.
Okay.
Let's start with the MM35s. Okay. And you have something you want to play.
Yeah, I'll start off with this song that Spike Stent mixed. Cool.
Done.
think I'd love to. I want to compare.
Yeah.
Because the bottom end is ridiculously good for a smaller speaker.
It is, and let me show you why that, how that might be explained. And forgive my wired mic.
No, please.
So check this out. On the front, it looks like a 5-inch mid or woofer, like you'd normally
sure.
see. So Barefoot was one of the first modern manufacturers to resurrect an old concept, which was this dipole woofer design. So you basically have woofers on either side of the cabinet. And in this case, Barefoot calls them force-opposing woofers. Mm-hmm. And so you have essentially a pair, in this case, a pair of 7-inch subs
yep.
firing sideways. And they're going in opposite directions. So normally on a speaker cabinet, anything with a front-facing woofer, you have to, the cabinet is always wanting to jump back.
Sure.
And so the most accurate representation of the sound is if that cabinet is absolutely rigid, because that means that all of the energy that the amplifiers and the cones are transmitting into the room
sure.
is actually going into the room. But if the cabinet is moving back, and that's why you see these like speaker mounts or neoprene used, it's all about trying to anchor that speaker rigidly in space. Well, inherent to the Barefoot design is a pair of force-opposed subwoofers always firing in opposite directions, naturally canceling out the force applied on the cabinet. So this cabinet remains exactly rigidly in place.
Sure.
Okay, well, how do you have woofers that are firing to the side translate to the front? Well, the way, there's a couple things going on. I mentioned a moment ago that these are DSP speakers. So Thomas Barefoot has essentially time-aligned the woofers with the mid and the tweeter digitally, so that you end up with the woofer appearing in time as if it's right here in the same plane as the mid and the treble. So it comes out more like a point source. And the way that this radiation...
I believe you. I just can't figure out how you would do that.
Through DSP.
Yeah.
Right. So, let me explain. Okay, so you have... This is a three-way speaker.
Sure.
A lot of these designs that we're listening to are two or three-way. What does that mean? Okay. So... in a three-way, you've got the lows coming out of
sure.
one speaker, you've got the mids coming out of another, and then you've got the highs coming out of another. So
absolutely.
That's three ways, low, mid, high. A DSP crossover allows you to time the emergence of those frequencies. So the lows can be, even though they're physically behind the mid and the high, you can slightly delay the mid and the high so
sure.
that it sounds like all frequencies come out at the same time.
No, I totally understand that. I suppose my question was really because when, and I'm sure, I'm just trying to answer what I know what people are going to ask,
yeah.
is if this is sitting here and there is objects around it, like there are, like other speakers, which is typical in a studio, there'll be another pair here, or potentially another pair here, or a boombox in the middle, you know, it's just any speaker. How do you take into account all of these different sources of things and bouncing? And
totally.
That's the bit that confuses me, because I understand, yes, if in a perfect chamber,
right.
you know, you could calculate that easily because
right.
there's nothing in the way.
Mm-hmm.
So how do they do that?
Low frequencies are so long. There's a couple
sure.
of things. They're longer frequencies. They tend to be more omnidirectional, people
sure.
will say. So they would, the low frequencies actually are going to develop somewhere over there, somewhere
sure.
out here. So they're less sensitive to a boundary than higher frequencies coming out of the mid and the top.
Do you know where this is crossed over then?
I don't know the exact crossover point, but I can tell you that the net effect, I mean, any speaker, and this is like one of the main things that we really need to talk about in this video, is it's,
sure.
it's not just the monitors.
Sure.
It's your room. It's where you place them. I mean, these are key things. And I'm not saying that this speaker is immune to placement.
No, I'm just intrigued because,
yeah.
you know, that's the first thing I thought when I started seeing these kind of designs coming out. It's a natural question. I'm sure anybody
yeah.
who sees this goes, well, yes, that's great in the perfect room.
Yeah.
But nobody has the perfect room.
Absolutely not.
You know, and we all have multiple sets of speakers or we wish to, or we put boom boxes or all kinds of stuff gets stuck in the way. So I just wondered if that was...
Yeah.
Yeah, and I do wonder where this crosses over. I mean, is it 150 and below, or is it much higher than that? I mean, is it?
You know, there's so many speakers that I'd have to memorize the
sure.
spec on. We can look it up, but
okay.
Just to underscore this point, you can have the greatest speaker in the world.
Sure.
As you're talking about, like the anechoic chamber, where they design it and make sure the frequency response is totally flat. Where the rubber meets the road in your room, the room has the biggest effect of anything. You can have a mediocre speaker in a great room sound way better than one of the world's best speakers in a crappy room.
Right, but I also find, I was talking to Neil Avron about this, it also comes down to, there's a couple of other factors as well. Obviously, I've had my room rung out, and it sounds pretty flat. There's some low mid bumps of like 350, which is funny because over the years I've been tucking less and less. I've got so used to it.
Right.
But it's relatively flat with the basic acoustic treatment I've done. However, right at the very back is not that good.
Oh, yeah.
But so it comes down, because, you know, Neil Avron was talking about this with his room. He was like going, well, it's not really that flat, but it sounds really good here. And, you know, that was the same thing that was a discussion that Barry Rudolph had with me about acoustic design, and even John Brandt. They all bring up the same thing, as it's kind of a balancing act.
Oh, yeah.
If you're working on your own, the most important thing is that it sounds great where you're working. You know, it's so, you know, I think that's something that gets ignored a lot, because people can spend a lot of time and money, you know, making their room acoustically true, but if they're not actually sitting in their back corner, it might not be as important. But anyway, I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
There's no perfect room.
Right.
And
that's a good line. There's no perfect
room.
There's
no perfect room, and every room is acoustically a compromise to one degree or another.
Oh, I see. That's a good line.
So idealize it, or tune it for where you're most often using it. So the mix position, that's a common one.
Great.
And you'd be amazed, everybody would be amazed at how much moving a pair of speakers a few inches this way or that way, away from the wall, a little bit wider, looking at how they might be reflecting off a console or a desk or a control surface, what a huge influence that has on what sound translates to the mix position. So that's where I always recommend that people start.
That's cool, because I had Genelec come down and ring out my room, and they told me that little low mid bump, but they were, you know, it was remarkably flat in the area where I work in. Now, it could be better still, but there wasn't any like massive spikes of frequencies that you know, I would have experienced in other rooms.
And, you know, to reassure people, that while there is no perfect room and all rooms are some degree of compromise, there are basic things that you can do that are not expensive and that are simple
to
mitigate most of the problems.
And what would you recommend?
Placement, number one. But in terms of acoustic treatment, bass traps in the corners. Did you know that every boundary amplifies the low frequencies, or reinforces the low frequencies, by 6 dB? So that's basically a doubling of energy in a corner. Actually, in a corner, it's 9 dB. So floor to wall, that's 6 dB, corner 9 dB. So that's where the bass energy is really being reinforced and bouncing back. So if you put a trap there, something that will slow down those waves, absorb them with basically what is acoustic treatment? It's something that it takes the acoustic energy, which is basically just air molecules moving, and it converts them to heat inside insulation, like a rigid fiberglass panel. And when you place them strategically, and most of the off-the-shelf products these days, it make it really easy for you to place them properly.
Right.
So I was saying the short list, some bass traps in the corners or at boundaries, and then treating first reflections. You've probably heard that one a lot. So let's say your mix position is right out here.
Right.
Your first reflections would be in the ceiling above you, between you and the monitors, and left and right on the walls, and then the back of the room. Any place where you have that first bounce. So you want to capture as much as possible the direct sound coming from the speaker to your ears, and decrease that first bounce, that first early reflection, so to speak. And you can do that for a matter of, you know, hundreds of dollars rather than, you know. But let me just say why that's important. You know, if you invest $7,000 plus in a pair of great monitors like these, and you put them in a room that's got those issues, you're just not going to get the most from those monitors.
Right, absolutely. Well, that makes perfect sense to me. So let's do something, because let's move to, could we easily move to, say, to these speakers between these?
Yeah, we can.
I know they're not, I just want to hear a difference in approach from a different manufacturer. Because I know, as you said, that the Barefoots are voiced similarly, so Well, I do want to hear the other barefoots, but I want to hear something quite drastically different.
Cool, let's do
so
it.
So I can get this perspective on
and,
it.
And that's a good choice, Warren, because we're actually moving from a three-way to a two-way.
Okay, great. Case.
That'll be fun. Let me just patch that.
Okay, so let's go to the barefoots back again. So there. And then if you don't mind, would you mind switching to the PMCs? And I'll sort of move my head in the right position.
The PMCs are patched in on, if you hit main, we'll hear those.
Well, what would be awesome is if I don't move.
Okay.
I can, you know what I mean? I can, if I get up and move and come back.
Okay.
Oh, thank you. Better still. Movable. Wow. So bad different. I mean, it's as my dad would say, it's chalk and cheese. They couldn't be more different. Really, very, very different. It's if I was to just like do the dumb quick analogy of what I just heard was good tight low bottom end.
Yeah.
Nice definition, nice depth. It's interesting, we were just talking to Eric about this. We were at Tommy Lee's studio the other day, which is like probably about three videos back by now. And his engineer and Tommy himself love PMCs. And again, it's a huge control room compared with mine, compared with this. So that probably affects their choice in speaker.
Right.
So I think that's probably another thing that, you know, is worth. I don't know if I would put these in a massive room.
And they're not designed for that. Yeah, they're designed to be full range, but in a near field setting.
I mean, this size of room, do you think they're pretty applicable for this room?
You know, I know a lot of engineers who like to mix at a reasonable level.
Mm-hmm.
At tracking levels where you need way more transients and maybe you've got the clients in the back and you need to pump it
great
up.
Great point.
This is not probably the solution unless you're in a very small room.
Well, that's a great point. I'm glad you bring it because a lot of this discussion is about what's the difference in the speakers, but why are people buying them?
Right.
Because, you know, you guys have incredibly educated clients. I'll be honest, whenever I come in here, there's like two or three of my friends and peers and people far more experienced than me walking around buying gear, talking gear. So you've got a very educated client base, which is another great reason to come here because you've got your clients who are educated, you guys are educated.
And I learn tons from my clients also.
Oh, God. Yeah, so do I. I learn more from the comments than I get
from
the teacher. Yeah, people tell me, you did that wrong. I'm like, yeah, I know. I'm not an expert. Thanks for helping me. I have like this mix academy and everybody in there does amazing mixes. They get so good and they come up with all these great ideas and the tracks that I mix. So I'm like, that's a great idea. I should do that. It's like, it's all about community.
You could edit together the best mix, you know, chorus from this guy, verse from that guy.
I'm sure it's been done many times before. All right. So anyway, back off of my tangent there. So the PMCs in Tommy's room, they're tracking drums there all day.
Right.
And they've got a large control room. So I get that big girth. I mean, the thing is about this, the difference is so stark. They both sound great, but the differences are massive. There's lows on this, there's lows on that. You get those same feeling of the lows, the kick there, the real low lows are there. But there's a little bit, and I know this song really well, and I respect this mixer. This is Spike Stent. This is one of the greatest mixers
one of
in the
my
world.
Favorites, yeah.
Arguably top two or three and interchangeable number
but
one
mixer.
We can't
really like rate them. I mean, they're just that when you get to that level, they're just like, my God.
No, Spike's amazing. And I sat in a room when he was mixing and it blew my mind. But anyway, getting back to the point, so the low lows are there, but there is definitely a lot more low mids in there, which sort of cloudy up some of the kick for me. Where this has a little bit of a clean, tight bottom end. I feel the kick low down, I feel those lows. But I also, it feels a little closer to my experience of when we were mixing, that I felt the kick, and then I felt the bass sitting there, and then I felt the low mids of the guitars and everything up. Where this one, it's kind of like kick, bass, guitar. So it's all there. It's just not necessarily as defined. Now, that's probably a lot to do with the fact of the design and the fact that they're three-way rather than two, in their defense. you know, that's a, this is a three-way speaker, not a two-way. But I think a good point that you were touching on a minute ago that we talked about was the fact that these probably are amazing for tracking because they put so much air out and so much of that low mids when you're tracking. But I don't know, six of one, half a dozen the other.
You know what's great about you coming in here and not knowing
I know nothing
too
about,
much
about,
right,
the Beffords.
About either of these speakers is that you're pointing out things that if I were to just describe to someone who is really familiar with the consequences of various sure. speaker designs, they would say, oh, well, naturally, a speaker of this type will have this type of performance. And what you
I'm
just
not
figured
an expert,
out.
So.
Yeah, but you've got, I every time we talk, I can tell from what you say, you have great ears because. What you're hearing, part of that is the consequence of this design. Okay, so this is not a sealed cabinet, and it has an acoustic transmission line in it. What does that mean? There's like a network of folds back here inside the cabinet, and this is a port here behind this cloth, this grill cloth. And what that does, long story short, is it allows an 8-inch speaker to act like a much larger speaker because it's moving this huger volume of air back in that tuned network and bringing that out in phase with this woofer, extending the low frequency range, okay? But you can't get like a lot of, in anything in life, you can't get something for nothing. Or like if something's really great at this, there might be a compromise with something else. And in this case, the compromise with a non-sealed cabinet design, while you can get more extended low end, you might have a compromise in tightness. And so what you loved about this sealed cabinet design of the Barefoot, the tightness, the accuracy of all those low frequencies, is not so much present in the
sure.
in the PMC.
That makes sense.
How does the Barefoot then get that bottom end? By basically adding together two 7-inch subwoofers, which together is like having, you know, I don't know if it's exactly 14-inch, but a much larger subwoofer.
Right.
Right. So great ears on that one, Warren. And, you know, we're really comparing apples to apples here. These are 8,000, these are 8,275 around there. And what I would do, because I've heard...
Can I interject for something?
Yeah.
Because I think it's important, and I don't want to... Just because what's going through my mind is the Tommy Lee experience and also my experience of tracking. Most engineers that I know end up as mixers.
Right.
But they don't start off as mixers. The great mixers were producers, usually engineers, producers, mixers. Most guys and girls seem to end up in the second half of their career becoming mixers. Because they've developed those ears, you know, they've been engineering for a long time.
Yeah.
One of the frustrations, I was talking about this with David Bendiff, is like Bendiff said he hated mixing for years. And I know why, because when you're tracking, there's something satisfying about tones that are this big.
Yeah.
You know, hearing like 40 and 60 hertz on everything and low mids and thickness and top end.
Yeah.
But when you mix and you want to compact everything into a pair of speakers or earbuds or whatever it might be, you tend to carve things up to get all of that detail in there. But it's kind of unrewarding to listen back to some professional mix when you're an engineer because you're like, where's all that? Yeah. And so I don't know if PMC are going to like me saying this, but these scream at me as like, wow, these would be amazing to track through. Like so much lows and energy, and hence why Tommy and those guys are tracking drums through them. It's like, you know, I'm sure you can mix on them, don't get me wrong, but it almost feels like the difference between the experience of tracking and mixing.
Okay, and so before the jury's out on that, what I would do, let's say you came in here and said, Alex, I'm looking for a speaker in the $8,000 range.
Right.
I've heard the PMCs sound very different depending on how they're placed and what room. I know lots of composers who use
Great.
Them. I know lots of mixers who use them just as much as the Barefoots. So here's what I would do as a next step, because right now the PMCs do sound a bit tubbier than I'm accustomed to hearing them.
Okay, great.
So what I would do is I would clear off this shelf. I would we put as many speakers out here as possible for us today so that we could quickly go through and compare them.
Great.
I would place these a little bit differently. These are also capable of doing a 90-degree vertical placement.
Great.
And in fact, you can rotate this tweeter to accommodate either horizontal position or vertical position. I think that we could get these set up so that it was a much closer comparison, actually.
Okay, good.
All based
well,
on,
the high mids and everything in these are fantastic.
Yeah.
Like super, super detailed. All I was doing the chalk and cheese differences on the lows.
And I
low
heard
mids.
The same thing. I heard the same thing. And I know that... you know, we're basically with the height of this shelf simulating a seated position. And I'm hearing a little bit of reflection that you could easily take care of with some speaker platforms.
you know, so recoil stabilizers or isoacoustics, the right height. So all those things we talked about before,
sure.
you can make a lot more of any speaker by placing it properly.
But you know what's interesting? And see, this is my opinion, and I'm not an expert. I wouldn't track with these.
Okay.
I don't know. I just feel like they're really detailed, and I love them, and they sound fantastic.
What do you like for tracking? What kind of sound?
I always use my Genelex. I like a lot of lows, a lot of low mids. People feel satisfied when they've been sitting out in a live room with a pair of little crappy headphones on.
So true.
You know, because whatever, everybody uses 7506s or whatever. You know, I've been using those extreme headphones isolation because they have great isolation.
Yeah.
Not the best sounding, but they're great bang for the buck. They sound much better than like the Vic Firth ones, which are same price, but just squash your head and don't sound very good. At least these have an extended low end. But there's just, so you throw your headphones down, you come in the tracking room, and you want to be blown away.
God, I fear that moment as a tracking engineer.
You want
everybody's been hearing like this perfect mix that they wanted to be hearing. And they're in the room with the drums live, and they come in, they hear these teeny little 8-inch speakers.
Yeah. So these scream at me, tracking room. I mean, these are up in a room that they did the Smashing Pumpkins last record in, they did... done tons of stuff. Motley Crue's last record. I mean, like, you know, these are rock guys. Mm-hmm. So they're not stupid. And also, it's Tommy. He's not going to be short of funds on buying the right speakers. So, and that's why I want to know about the people that buy it. Because, especially people that can afford anything, because you know they're buying it for specific reasons. And I do know that I'd be very satisfied to track through these. Because that's just putting a bass through that nice, it just would sound great. Like, nobody wants to try a bass on a pair of NS10s.
What's your phrase? Horses for courses?
Horses for courses.
And so basically what that means, because that's like native to the UK, right, that phrase. But what it means is like you sort of fit, there's something for everyone? Is that the...
Well, like there's certain horses that run really great in wet. There's
great.
Some
okay,
that run
it.
Really great in dry.
Got it.
And it's a sort of pre-stats. You know, now Americans are so good. You guys are so fantastic at understanding players' performances in different kinds of environments, with different players, you know, at different fields, with different whatever, different times of day. Then you know everything. Well, back in ye olden days, when it came to horse racing, they would literally look at, like, it was raining today, it was ultra muddy, this horse ran. And after a while, they would build up mental stats on which horses were best. So it's horses for courses. Like, oh, this horse is great in the wet. So they'd all bet on that.
Cool. So that's basically what you've said. For your course, which would be a tracking scenario, you'd like the PMC.
And
in the bottom, big balls, a lot of
talk about mud flaps, my girl's gone. I mean, and the more we talk about it, even though we started off with like loving this over this from the actual playback, in a lot of situations, this is probably more, over 50% more what I'd need. Hmm. You know what I mean? And there's something about substantial, but it's amazing. It's like it's amazing how they're both very, very, very soft and detailed in the right way in the mid range. What I mean by soft is they don't sound like scooped. I just mean they're not offensive like an NS10 is. They sound sweet in the mid range. Both of them are very detailed there.
And a testament to your mixer engineers on this record too.
Yeah, I mean it's Spike Stent, not me. I mean I recorded it, but I mean. What? Let's keep on this song for a minute, and let's go. You tell me. Let's go to something else. I love this idea.
Great. Let's do another comparison. Let's go to a different barefoot.
That's a good idea.
Slightly lower price point. So we started out at the MM35, the little brother of the MM27. That's $82.75. This pair of barefoots is. I'll have to double check this price, but it's a couple grand lower than.
Oh, it is cheaper.
Barefoots. Yeah.
Bigger but cheaper. What?
Check this out. So traditional cabinet design, right? So you have the woofer firing directly at you. There's no subs on the side.
Oh, wow.
A single 8-inch woofer, sealed cabinet. And let's compare that. Actually, you know, one of the closest comparisons and what people are often coming here wanting to compare is those barefoot MM45s against the ATC SCM25s. And we might not capture this on the video, but the SCM25s from ATC are ported on the side. So what does that do? Extends the bottom a little bit. And but again, it'll be perhaps less specifically tightly controlled in the bass because of that.
So essentially, these are in the same-ish price range?
Same-ish price
range. Okay, good.
And look, they're almost exactly the same size.
Right.
They're both three-way.
And it's a common comparison. So let's check it out.
You know what I love about this as well? It's important to remember. There's no Genelex here, and I use Genelex. So this is interesting. So it's taking me out of my comfort zone and making me like just hear things really fresh. I like that. It's nice to be outside of your comfort zone.
Oh, Avid S6.
Ah, another expensive mouse.
Nice for some faders, though. Okay, so $8,000. All right.
Oh, so they're both $8,000?
No, the barefoots are $6,000.
Ah.
And the ATCs are $8,000.
Okay. All right, ready, Eric?
We'll get this.
Okay, so to remind me, what's the first one here?
Okay, the pair on that first switch on the main is the Barefoot MM45. Those are $59.95. Okay. And your second selection is ATC SCM25A for $89.95. They're both three-way designs.
Okay, great. How much are the ATCs?
ATCs are $79.95.
So what's different about there's two things really markedly different about the ATCs. They have an amazing dispersion. They seem super wide. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's big. Top end is there are a lot brighter speakers.
Yeah.
But airy, nice. Not 3 to 5K, you know, NS10 bleeding ear, but like actual air on the top, like 7 and above. Like.
Yeah, like pretty, pleasing.
Yeah, pleasing. I hear the little snap on the snare. I hear the air on a vocal. I hear the overheads. I hear the detail on the drums.
Yeah.
I'm going to be a real, real pain.
Sure.
Because they're in the same price range, can we compare those with the other barefoots?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so these barefoots are still patched.
Yep.
So I'm going to listen to these barefoots and these ATCs.
Yep. Essentially the same price by a few hundred dollars.
So these are the ATCs. They're a lot similar than I thought. There's definitely a slight added air to these ATCs than there is over here, like a Nats. And the bottom end is fantastic on them, and the detail on the lows is really, really good. But they still have it beat for the super lows, strangely enough, considering how much smaller they are, because of their design. These are markedly different, considering they're from the same manufacturer,
they
I'll
really
be honest.
Are. And one of the main differences is this mid driver, which was pulled from the flagship Barefoot MM12s, which are over there standing up.
Yeah.
So these have a bit more of a forward and detailed mid range.
Sure.
Or a different character in the mid range.
Character, yeah.
Than the Barefoot 35s.
So I'm listening to these Barefoots at the moment. And then we're going to go to the other barefoots. And it's not as markedly different. Hovering around. Quite ridiculous, don't I? Hovering around. So a little bit, are the baffles a little bit more efficient? Like a gnat's? No, they're not. I do like these ATCs, I'll be honest. They would, if I was to be dumb,
yeah,
and just my gut reaction is right, that they live between these speakers. So like with this and this, these live in the middle. Do you know what I mean? They have definitely have more low definition, the tightness of the barefoot, but not as much, you know. But I do like the top end detail on whatever this tweeter is, whatever they've done here is pretty tasty.
I think of ATCs as really pleasing music speakers. They're
right.
I mean, you want to think that everything is musical sounding, but sure. I'd say that Barefoot's approach, as I've observed, is to be, on their own website, they'll call them brutally honest, but let's just say that there's an almost like a musical sweetness to these, yet accuracy. I think it's a really good combination of musical sweetness and accuracy, and people like instantly gravitate to that. Like, I love when I'm going back and playing my mixes in this room, as soon as I put them on the ATCs, I'm like, oh, that sounds so good.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I think from the mixing ear point of view, the lows and the low mids are in the middle of these two. You know what I mean? It's got some of the real tightness of the definition on the lows as these, but it's also got a lot more low mid girth that these have.
And you're asking, you know, who's buying these?
Yeah.
The lows are not quite as extended in the SCM25As mm-hmm. from ATC. If you can get the lows out of them if you add a sub. I mean, mm-hmm. that's another conversation. But you're absolutely right. You know, they're. The PMC228s that we were checking out have more extended bottom, but the ATCs do live right in the middle, kind of in terms of voicing, because they have some of that sheen of the PMC, but a more focused, because it's a 308 design also, mm-hmm. I mean, that's like the most glaring thing here. The PMCs we listen to two-way, you know, 8-inch woofer and a tweeter, and then these are, you know, have this beautiful dome mid, which has like very supple, mid-range.
Supple.
And
no,
detailed.
It's great.
Supple and detailed. Just like your mixes.
These are my mixes. These are spike stents. Not mine. Okay. I went to a world-class mixer for reference.
Well, let me change that. Supple and detailed.
Right.
Just like your hair.
Everybody knows my hair has a life of its own. What is it doing today? I don't know. We did a video this morning where I was wearing headphones for like 2 hours, so it's probably nice and flat.
It's still supple and detailed.
Supple and detailed, yeah. Tell my wife. Okay, great. Well, I'm learning a lot about these. It's very interesting. I still feel like these are like my workhorse speakers. These are, you know, I just feel good about, maybe it's just because they're physically big as well as all that low end. I feel like I could track drums smacking through those, and having actually heard them tracking drums through them, mm-hmm. I've also got a little bit of a, of all the speakers here, these are the only ones I've ever used before.
Okay.
But only for one day, mm-hmm. but it was a week ago, so I have a kind of a good memory of them. These are just amazing. I can imagine mixing on these is a dream. I would say these probably remind me a little bit of what I like about Genlex. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know if anybody's ever made that comparison, but maybe that detail on the top end, a little tiny bit shimmery up there, makes it pleasing, mm-hmm. And great low end. So this isn't the Focals.
Great, let's do that. And one more note before we pass from these. If you're an electronic producer and you mm-hmm. bring in a track that's got a lot of information below, 60, 50, 40, sure. going all the way down, you're definitely going to hear more of that on the PMCs and the Barefoot 35s.
Right.
So again, horses for courses?
Am I sure.
using that right?
That's perfect, cool. Right. Horses for courses.
Right, so an EDM producer is going to come in here and compare.
Right.
And they're going to hear more of the sub-information that they absolutely need to hear to balance their mixes from the Barefoot 35s and from the PMC 22s than they would from the ATC 25s. But you know, someone producing a lot of guitar-oriented music might really gravitate to the ATC 25s because of that supple mid-range, again, the supple detail.
Yeah, no, that makes perfect sense.
Presented by the ATC. All right, so let's switch over to the Focal SM9s. Here's a quick interesting point on these. Eric, I don't know if you can see the top of the speaker. I can, of course, and you can because we're both so tall.
He's taller, obviously.
Barefoot put the subwoofers on the side. Yeah. Force canceling subwoofers. So this is like that, but it's a passive radiator. So it's a sealed cabinet with this extra bit of, let's think of it as like, it's a basically a passive woofer. So when this woofer pushes out, it creates an air pressure change in here, but rather than the cabinet absorbing that force or all the force being controlled by the amplifier coming out of this one driver, some of that air pressure can be used and not lost. And it gets, so this top hat sort of looking speaker gets pushed up and increases the load.
You might watch that.
Yeah. Oh yeah. We're going to be able to watch that. Let's pump these up.
Now we've got the focals in and we've got the ATCs beautifully on top of each other. So ATCs are up. Okay, so a lot of moving around there. Sorry, I was moving around between speakers quite a lot to kind of get an idea of how they sounded. These are remarkably good.
The focals.
Yeah, right? Really, really good. What kind of price range are they?
Those are just shy of 8,000, so all in the same price range essentially, right?
So really, it's only these ones that are not in the same price range.
Right. Yeah, the 45s are $6,000 for the pair.
Great. And this low worked. If you saw me, hopefully Eric got it, I came up and I just kind of like moved towards it and you really did feel that extra low coming out here. So there wasn't a huge amount of movement, maybe if I cranked the, you know, schnizzle out of it, but right. It was a sort of slight vibration, but the lows were definitely evident. The detail here was remarkable. Mm-hmm. As I came up close to them, I was like, wow, those are very, very pleasing.
And a really opposite approach with the tweeter between the ATCs and the Focal. So Focal uses beryllium, which is like one of the lightest metals known to man, or most rigid or something like that. But what it does is it has the benefit of being so, they can make it so thin and so light and rigid that it very instantaneously transmits those transient details.
Wow.
So immediately when we switch to the Focals, and I think you heard it too, you hear the detail on the top end.
Beryllium.
Beryllium. Yes. Reminds me of the 80s band Beryllium.
Beryllium, yes. With Fish, the lead singer.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Yes.
And so the ATC's a really traditional approach to the tweeter, a soft dome. And so like 90-some percent of the world, we are probably used to hearing soft dome tweeters. So go to the ATC's, feels very familiar. It feels very comfortable. It's like, oh, yeah, I know the soft dome sound. It's a really different sound compared to the Beryllium tweeter.
There is something, and this is a quick generalization because that's just that's me, isn't it? These three definitely live in the same family, though.
Yeah.
This one definitely has the best low definition of all of them. But they all sort of live in the same family where this has that sort of like sturdiness in the low mids, like again, which isn't necessarily bad for certain people. And as you said, for EDM guys that want to have a lot of energy going on in those lows, then they're going to gravitate towards the PMCs.
All that information down there.
I'm actually very impressed with these.
And fun listening speakers too. That's the thing about it. Another big point. All speakers need to be learned.
Right.
I don't want anyone going home with a pair of $8,000, $10,000 speakers thinking, now I can trust everything I hear. You still have to learn your speakers. And I was going to ask you, in your process when you're mixing, do you do a lot of comparing to other mixes that you're either familiar with or you like or you're inspired by?
Depends. If it's entirely something I tracked, not that much.
Right, okay.
But when I'm mixing other people's stuff, oh yes, all the time, because I don't really have a Yeah, I mean, I could have a systematic way of working. I have a console I use all the time. I work hybrid. I have certain plugins I like. I have certain outboard. All of that stuff affects how I hear it, right. And I can get from A to B really quickly. Mm-hmm. However, yes, I do. I reference because I don't really know when they've tracked. It's too much of a blank canvas for me. There's not. Yeah. That's great for the excitement level and to bring something new to it. Because usually the with a good rough mix, you can hear glaring, obvious things that need to be fixed, which would be true of even the person who mixed the rough mix in themselves. I don't have that much of an ego where I believe that that engineer himself couldn't have mixed it if he was given the opportunity of another day to mix the song, sure. Standing away from it. Because I've been in that situation, I'm sure you have as well, where somebody else is mixing your record, but you never had a chance to mix it.
Yeah, and maybe you needed a better room, monitors, or a day to take a break.
Yeah, so it's nice. Exactly. So it's nice to have. Yeah, and exactly. Especially you're tracking a record, you're doing 15-hour days, 6 weeks, 6 months sometimes. I mean, you know. But anyway, so it's nice to have the rough mix references, and then of course, things that live in that family. I've always had two or three songs that I go to.
Yeah.
Strangely enough, one Spy Xtent, anything Spy Xtent almost. Muse, when he did that Muse album 2 albums ago, phenomenal mixes. Phenomenal mixes. Yeah. Just energy and excitement, but clarity, which is tough to do.
So you said
because you can clean up everything and get detailed, and then all the energy goes from the mix. But Spike has a way of keeping detail, hearing everything in its place, but it still sounds like the most threatening, dangerous mix.
Yeah, impact.
And there's a lot of reasons why. You know, lots of saturation he does, lots of delays. He does lots of fun things. But then Mark Ender, who's another guy mixed on this album. Hey Soul Sister is one of the best sounding mixes ever in the history of mixes. Mm. And I know three mixers, which I won't name check, one of them is Dave Pensado, that has that as their reference.
Okay.
When I mixed with Dave, we mixed Daniel Powter track. One of the three songs he uses as a reference was Hey Soul Sister. It would be foolish not to say a great mix is a great mix.
Yeah.
Now it's empty. It's just a vocal and a ukulele and like two or three instruments and then a kick drum comes in with a... But it doesn't matter. It's just that clarity and that vocal sound. It's inspiring. So there are things I go back to. So it's, and if I brought that in and played it, we'd probably hear stark differences. Like that song in particular, it's probably on my. But I wanted to do something that I knew really, really well, and also I was there when I tracked and I was there when I mixed. So that's why I feel like I can make sweeping statements because I know how that track sounds.
Absolutely. And
much better than somebody else's track.
The key word you used was reference. So you're having references in different contexts. Sure. For some people, it's the car reference. But
I like how he was interviewing me. This was good. How you did that?
Well, I'm inspired by you, Warren.
Well, thank you. And vice versa.
So as a reference point, let's say you get, you know, the new $8,000 speakers in your studio. You still need to learn them. And so I was asking you about your process in terms of using tracks that you know well to reference. And that's what you did. You brought in a reference point. And I often, especially when I'm recording or mixing something that I haven't tracked, so I kind of don't know its DNA, so to speak. I need a reference point. And anybody, you know, changing speakers or changing studios, like if you go to a new studio, before you start to track, do you put something on the monitors that you know?
I do. When I'm tracking, I'm a little less fussy. Mm. Like I said, I've tracked with PMCs recently. I've tracked with Focals before, ATCs. I'm in a studio that was tracking with Adams. It doesn't have to be Genelex, which I know and love and know really well. I will track with other speakers, especially when you're in this kind of, because this is high-end price range for most people. When you're in this world, these are all amazing speakers. Mm-hmm. They're going to be amazing to track on. Having said that, when I came to mix, that's where I might get a little fussier. Yeah. Because it could be lying to me. Like if I took my ears that are used to my Genelex and applied them to the PMCs, I would scoop out a load of 150, 200, 250. I'd be pulling all of that out. Mm-hmm. And then we'd play them on a speaker like a barefoot and be like, where's all the body gone in the mix? Right. I would have just because there's so much of that in there.
Yeah. And partly to the fault of the placement just for this scenario.
Yeah, no, totally. But that kind of thought process where this sounded very much like the mix that I heard in Spike Stent's room, and I don't remember what speakers he used. Sorry, Spike.
You know, I actually sold Spike a pair of Barefoot MM27 Gen 1s a number of years ago. I don't know if he's still using them. He was referencing on NS10s.
Right. It was probably NS10s where we were there with the sub.
Yeah.
I think that's what we were.
And he had the KRKs, the kind of classic ones that are not made anymore. And then the MM27s. He likes, and then he has the boombox in the corner.
Yeah, we all love our boomboxes.
Three different boomboxes in the corner. Yeah,
Headphones and earbuds is my kind of. We had the Bose boombox, the Wave Radio. Yeah. That's an interesting way to listen to music.
Right. I know someone who mixes almost exclusively on one of those.
It does all kinds of crazy things to the face. It.
Oh yeah.
I don't know if I could do
that. That's one of those. That has one of those waveguide things in the back of it too. That's how they get so much low end out of that.
I'm so phased weird, like with stuff like that. I was watching one of those somebody's mix tutorial, and they were talking about making drums sound wider, and all they did was like delay one side slightly.
Oh no!
And I'm like, you know.
Well, you know, and whatever works, because sometimes I see people, you know, place a room mic asymmetrically, and you know, the engineer in me goes, oh no, it's, you know, it's not time aligned with the rest of the drum kit or whatever, but you know, when you blend that in, it might create this little bit of offset that psychologically, you know, so there's different ways to slice the pie.
Yep, exactly. Well, wonderful. Thanks ever so much for doing this. I know this is a...
I thought it was the handshake.
It was the handshake.
Was I premature?
No, it's okay. So the bishop to the actress. Another English one. Horses for courses, bishop to the actress, or actress to the bishop. That's our version of that's what she said. At least it's the old English version. So thanks ever so much. Yeah, it's definitely, this is the mid to high price range, the 6 to 8. We're not talking anywhere like sub $1,000. We should do a whole video just on that.
We need to.
Because that's not apples to oranges. You can't compare a $1,000 speaker to a $8,000 speaker.
Although I must say, compared to, let's just say 20 years ago.
Oh, yeah.
And when active monitors first came out, or when you couldn't. And by the way, these are all powered active monitors.
Absolutely.
Prior to this, with the category Genelec basically invented.
Yeah.
There was so much less consistency with monitors.
Absolutely.
And now, even for $1,000, $500, $2,000, you can get something amazing.
Let's remember, I'm sure you did as well. I bought my last pair of NS10s I bought from good old Guitar Center 20 years ago, 18 years ago, were $499.
Oh, yeah.
And the power amp was about $400 as well. It was either the Hafler, it's Bryston's become popular now, but the power amps, basically it was $1,000. And that was most of the world were mixing on that. And the Hafler was very popular with a lot of very, very big famous producers and mixers. We all kind of like talk down about some of that gear now. But I would go into studios with great mixing engineers, and they were mixing amazing sounded records with $400 or $500 MOSFET, toroidal transformer, power amps through a pair of NS10s, and they were buying the $100 Yamaha Cinema sub. So total $1,000, some of your favorite records were mixed on that, which would probably include something like Woman in Chains by Bob Clearmountain, which I would argue is one of the greatest mixes ever made, mixed on a pair of NS10s with a cheap sub. So yeah, it's a good point. It's like I think, going back to that discussion earlier, when you come up as the engineer and you evolve into the mixer and stuff like that, guys like Bob, the great, great mixers, Spike and Endert engineered Fiona Apple's first record, which is a masterpiece sonically. Yeah. That big Madonna record in the mid-90s, was it Music or something? He engineered that, and mixed it. So it's like, I think he mixed it as well, but we're talking guys with and I know Mark very well. He's obsessed with detail. He's obsessed. He'll spend ages, you don't get a Mac mix back for 2 days.
Right.
He doesn't have a system and he throws it up and sends it off to you in 3 hours. He spends 2 days on it. So those kind of people have developed ears and understanding, and then they can bring that information to a pair of NS10s and a cheap sub.
I want to invite people to do two things.
Please.
Finish King has this opportunity for folks to come and match what they want to hear, their type of music, their budget range, both at our LA showroom here where we are. And we call this the critical listening room. And this room is really designed for our high-end speakers to do what we did with your own music and your favorite references. We also have the Nashville showroom where we can do that.
I've been there. It's lovely.
Thank you. And also, most of these speakers are returnable within 30 days. So let's say...
Nice.
But let's take one step back from that. everybody that you're likely to talk to, finish being a salesperson, we are engineers, we're producers, we are people who are using the gear all the time, we're using this gear. And we can get you, if we have a conversation like a normal conversation, I would ask you about what style of music you produce. Are you a mixer, are you a tracking engineer, et cetera. We'd get enough data that we would get you very comfortable with making a decision about which speakers are going to work really well for you.
Absolutely.
And trying them out in your own studio. And let's just say that, you know, for some reason, it didn't quite work out.
I have. I mean, for years, for like 20 years, when I first started off here, Jeff would bring over stuff all the time.
Absolutely.
Jeff's been here for ages, hasn't he?
Jeff Ehrenberg established, his idea, Finnish King Los Angeles, was really his idea to have this showroom.
Right.
To have this kind of opportunity where you can walk in and hear the gear.
He's probably given me like $100,000 worth of gear over the years. He would just bring out and try out.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's, you know, I talk about this all the time. I work with people I have good relationships with.
Yeah.
And that's an important thing. Have good relationships with people. Yeah. All right. Thank you ever so much.
Oh, you're welcome, Warren. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Next conversation, we should definitely go
we'll
to
go and
other,
do the
other price speakers, right?
Yeah.
And a little bit more on acoustics and speaker placement.
Yeah.
I want to dive into that a little
definitely.
Bit.
Definitely. So we'll do that. We'll come back next week and do that.
Because
I know Ryan will be very happy. So thank you ever so much for watching. Have a marvelous time recording and mixing. We've probably opened up a huge can of worms with lots of different stuff, but I like the way Alex was talking about application. The fact that the PMCs have that extended low end and so much detail in the low mids and lows for guys that are mixing EDM and working EDM, that's probably going to give them a lot of love. But there's a real great similarity for me between these three sets of speakers here, which I love. I'd be hard pushed to go between me mixing, whether it be the Focals or the ATCs or the Barefoots. That is, those three for me are now going to come down, just as a mixing speaker comes down to personal preference.
It is.
You're going to get five different people in here and they're going to go, oh, that one's the best, that one's the best, that one's the best. And that's what's so great about it.
You different know? Versions of great right here.
Yeah, no, I agree. They live in the same kind of family to me. This definitely has like a crazy tight bottom end. Mm-hmm. Not, it's not so much, but this is a really good close second to the Barefoot in many respects. And you're right about the high-end detail. It's pretty amazing. But yeah, all great speakers and horses for courses.
Awesome. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.